Welcome to Out of the Hills with John Wright. Today we are down at the John Zacchio Fine Art Gallery in Manchester, and this is young Jonathan.
Pleasure.
And Father John.
How are you?
Good to see you. What do you guys have here?
This is a wall hanging that I did, or I should say I didn't do, but it's something that's being created, and it starts with an original painting, and then from the original painting, then it's converted into a product like this.
Wow.
And that's how an art license is about. It takes a piece of art and turns it into a product.
Neat. Well, I want to hear all about it.
Yeah.
Good morning, John. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for allowing us to be here. Tell me a little bit. We are in Manchester, Vermont.
Mm-hmm.
You have what is reputed to be the largest art gallery in the state of Vermont. Is that?
That's correct.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
So tell us a little bit about the gallery and what brought you here.
Well, let me go back to probably from the time I was born in 1942. I was born in Kingston, New York, and my parents were in the restaurant business. And as a boy, I was always around lots of people. And I was always influenced by how people looked and how they acted. And I used to do these little pencil sketches, which I think brought me into the art world. And my mother was somewhat of an artist herself. And as a boy, my father used to let me, when I started painting, I was like 12 years old, mom and dad would let me take paintings and put them in the restaurant. And it got to a point I was even selling my paintings in the restaurant, which was kind of fun. And from there, I decided to go to, from Kingston High School, I went on to college. And I got a degree in commercial art. I went to a school called Dutchess Community College in Poughkeepsie, New York. And when I finished Dutchess, then I took some courses at the Art Student League in New York. I was interested in fine art as well. Then I went on to Syracuse University, and I graduated from there. And I went to New York. And while I was in New York, I started working in advertising agencies. And I worked for a company called J. Walter Thompson. I was on the Ford account with J. Walter. And then I worked for Cunningham and Walsh. That was another company. But I got really tired of the rat race in the advertising business, that is, with product lines. And a friend of mine said that there was an opening in the music industry, and there was the president of Bell Records, his name was Larry Utah. I spoke to him, and he says, I have this new team of people, it's called the Fifth Dimension, and we would like you to do the covers for these people. So I started doing covers for, you know, Fifth Dimension, Seals and Crofts, that type of thing. And then it was an opening at Warner Brothers. And Warner Brothers Music, as well as Atlantic Records, was like all put together. So I became the creative director of Warner Brothers. And I was at Warner Brothers, we were doing a combination of sheet music as well as record covers.
Were you musical yourself, or?
Not really. I mean, I put some around on the piano, as you well know, John, but that's about it. I'm not a musician. My son, Jonathan, is, but I'm certainly not. And so, you know, at Warner Brothers, it was a fun thing. I was in my 20s, and it was a wonderful place to work.
Sounds like a huge leap to...
It was.
All of a sudden be artistic director of Warner Brothers?
Yeah, I think the thing that was fascinating was that I didn't think it would come that quickly. But I have to say that all the moves that I made, a lot of it was influenced by an uncle of mine, Ken Douglas. He was a really incredible person in his own right. And he was always, you know, saying, John, learn everything you can learn and then move on to the next thing. And move on to the next thing. Mm-hmm. And I kept doing that. I kept moving on and on and on. And while I was doing record covers, I was also doing magazine work. So I would do work for Life magazine, I was doing covers for Time magazine, I was doing work for Field and Stream, Reader's Digest. I would do these paintings for, you know, different things. And it got to a point at Warner Brothers that I decided if I can do this, I can open my own advertising agency, which I did in New York. So I opened an agency in New York City, and then I also opened an agency up in Kingston, New York, and Woodstock.
What time frame are we talking about? Is this the 60s? Or?
This would be the 70s.
Uh-huh.
This would
early
be the 70s. Early 70s. So then I opened an agency there, and what I would do is a lot of the advertising for example, in the upstate part, like Hunter Mountain, Cortina Valley, all these resorts as such. I would do all their advertising, promotion, television, everything for them. And then banks, like local banks, retail stores. I had a staff working for me, yep. It was called Zacchio Advertising. And I did that to a point that my art director was interested in buying my business, and I was interested in getting out of the business. And so I sold the business to him, and I moved to Palm Beach, Florida. And when I was down there, I had no idea what I wanted to do. So the first thing I did was I bought a house and boat, and traveled and had to go all the time. And then little by little, I started to find that people would ask me, like, what did you do for a living? And then I got interested with interior decorators in Florida, and the interior decorators then would, hire me to do paintings for their staff as such. And I had a good flair for interior decorating anyway. So, it worked. It was a beautiful partnership. And while I was doing that, there was a fella in Miami who had a wonderful art gallery in Miami, and he talked to me about possibly selling his business. He was ready to get out. And there was a fellow by the name of Michael O'Mahony, who was ahead of Mayer's Jewelers. And I spoke to Michael and Fidelity Investments at the time. I had a little bit involved there, and I knew some folks there. So we decided to open up a gallery down in South Florida in Fort Lauderdale.
So it impresses me that not only are you an incredible artist, but you obviously must have some real business savvy to have pulled together some of the things you're describing here. How would you describe that?
Well, the best way I could describe that is going back to my uncle Ken Douglas. He was VP of Grumman Corporation, and an incredible, brilliant man. He was always saying to me, John, you know, whatever you do, there's always a business side to whatever you do. And always, you know, never forget that part of it.
See, that's my downfall.
Well, we can work on that, John. So that's how that whole part's, you know, started. But in any case, going back to, you know, we started with a gallery in Fort Lauderdale, and Michael was a brilliant man in his own right, because he built an incredible jewelry business in South Florida, Mayer's Jewelers, which was a huge operation. And he became CEO of this new company, which we call Wentworth Galleries. And Wentworth Galleries was a great name. Not that there was ever a Wentworth, but it has that ambiance about it. So we call it Wentworth Galleries. And I work with Michael in different capacities. One capacity, of course, is that I created art for the company. And in a matter of 3 or 4 years, we went from 3 galleries to 40 galleries. We were the largest gallery chain in the world, and we had 40 galleries in every major mall in the United States.
As this was evolving, did you ever find yourself saying, wait a minute, I just want to be an artist?
Well, I mean, for the most part, that's what I was. I was an artist working with the company. I had no executive part of the company, just the fact that Michael and I got along splendidly for like 11 years. And in that 11 years, I must have had 50 one-man shows all over the United States, and God knows how many paintings I sold, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of paintings and lithographs and all that kind of stuff as well. So I did that for 11 years, but I was having difficulty with my shoulder because I was producing, literally for them, $2,000 paintings a week, which is, I mean, it's
unheard of.
It's unheard of.
Maybe one a month would be.
Yeah. So I was like a madman with a palette knife. Yeah. So at the end of 11 years, the doctor was telling me, you know, enough is enough. I mean, in the morning, I'd have a massage therapist come to the house and work on me. I'd paint all day. He'd come back at night, work on me. And he says, we can't keep doing this. You're going to destroy.
It's ironic. No matter what your profession, we all run up against the same thing. There are just physical limitations to what you can do.
Physical limitations. And that's exactly what happened, you know. So at that point, you know, my son Jonathan, he loves snowboarding, and we wanted to get out of Palm Beach, you know. So what happened, which was really kind of interesting, is that we came up here on a little trip, and then I went back home, and I said to my son and my wife, I said, I think we ought to move, and we'll move to Vermont, because my ex-wife's family came from Vermont, and it's a beautiful area, and it wasn't far from where I was brought up in Kingston, New York, so it was a nice, I could see my family more often, I could be with her family more often, and my son loved it for snowboarding. So the thing that was so funny was that I put the house on the market, and the very morning I put it on the market, the realtor calls me up and says to me, by the way, your house, I said, oh, you're putting the sign, I'm sorry, you're putting the sign out in front of the house. She says, no, I just sold your house and you have a month to move. So my wife,
it was meant to be.
My wife said to me, she said, gosh, you better get out there and find us a house, you know? So I came up to Vermont and I found a buyer broker, and I found like five houses that I really loved and in a very nice area. And so we bought the house, and by God, the time that we had to move in, we had a blizzard. It was probably the worst blizzard we had in all the years, right?
So what year was this?
This was around 2000, uh-huh. You know? So we had this big snowstorm. So anyway, even bringing the trucks up to the house, they couldn't make it up the hill, so I had to pay for these guys to stay in town for like 2 days until we get up the house. And then when it came time to moving in, the problem was we had such a big house in Florida that we moved in a smaller house that we had a three-car garage here, and the house was just full of stuff. And I had this fellow called Donnie Dorr had these big trucks, so I had to get one of those things. And we had that out there until spring till we could, you know, little by little sell everything off to move, to live in.
To fit in.
But You know, coming to Vermont, it was like such a pleasure, such a change for me. And of course, the beauty of painting, because it's such a beautiful area to paint. And the folks here are just great. I mean, you know, I just love, you know, they're all down to earth. They're all just wonderful people here. I find myself feeling so good living here. And all the artists and everything that I have as well, it's like a family. You know, these are like, you know, I'm like mother hen. Right. I have all these chicks, you know. Yeah.
And Vermont is rich with artists.
Oh, they're very rich, yeah. This is a wonderful area for artists, and they're so dedicated to what they do and everything else. And speaking of that, when I came up here, I actually retired again. I was going to paint, you know, for my own pleasure, but not to sell anything. And, you know, by that time I had built a reputation, you know, nationally. So there was this magazine called Art Business News, and a dear friend of mine now, Jack Appleman, who at the time owned a company called Art License, or not Art Licensing, it's Art Licensing now, but it was called Applejack, Art Partners. And so Jack and I got together, and so Jack said to me, I'd like to hire you as my art director. And I said, for what? And he says, well, for art licensing. I said, Jack, I don't know anything about art licensing. He said, yeah, but you know about art, you know about marketing, you know about these things. And he says, well, I have 250 artists, you're going to have to, you know, whatever. And so I said, okay. So, but I learned quickly, you know. And it was a fun thing. So I was his director for a number of years and then decided, you know, enough of that, so I'll open my own art gallery. And all my work is still licensed through his company, which now is called Art Licensing. And licensing, for the folks out there that don't know about that, and that don't know about art licensing, it's basically taking an image and then turning it into a product. A product, like, it becomes a puzzle, it becomes It could be wallpaper, it could be a coffee cup, it could be a t-shirt, it could be...
You still have the rights to that image.
Regardless. I still have the rights to the image, yeah. Yes. Yes, yeah. Yep. And then you can take a product like a painting of any kind, a landscape or anything, and later I'll even show you one or two pieces to give you an idea of what we're talking about as far as this is what we start with and this is what we get.
Now you love to paint, but looking quickly around the gallery, I see you work in many mediums. What?
Yeah, and there's a very interesting reason for that too. A lot of times people say, once you have a style, that's your style. And that's fine, because some people, they develop that style to the point where they're extremely good at that particular look. But when I was in New York, I was always trying to get work. So somebody could say, can you paint in this style or that style? So it got to a point I was painting in like 20 or 30 different styles. Mm-hmm. Now, just to give you an idea, in licensing, what I do is I have all these pen names. My name is John Zacchio, John Newman, John Douglas, Debbie Lake, which is my ex-wife's name, Debbie Lake, Maria Amendola. And people always kid me. They always say, well, what's going to happen if you ever have a show? I said, well, I'll deal with that when it happens.
So the idea is each one of those identities has their own style.
Own style, right.
And so
right.
You differentiate by...
Yeah, exactly right. Yeah. They differentiate from each other. So
it's not unlike being an actor and having different...
Well, it's like actors. I mean, there are actors who can play different roles and play them well. And then there are other actors, they only can play a certain role. Right. You know, they can either be a bad guy or a good guy, right, or whatever they are. But I've always had the ability to be able to diversify myself. And my interest in life is especially since I've been here, like, I'm really interested in astronomy. I have a big telescope. I want to build an observatory. I have a lab at home because my minor was chemistry. I love chemistry. I make my own oil paints. I like to collect rocks and dinosaur bones, and I have arrowheads. And my son Jonathan's the same way. I mean, we are so much alike.
Yeah, you know, scary.
It's scary. It is too scary. Some of the good and some of the bad, but we have it. What can I say? You know?
So back to the mediums. You do a lot of oil painting, but you've done metal sculpture.
Yes, I studied painting in France, in Paris, and I studied sculpting in Rome. And in my sculpting, for many years I worked in marble, and I would do like life-size figures in marble. And then in painting, I had more of an impressionistic style, and I really studied the impressionists. You know, I would paint. I would actually go where Monet painted. I would go where all these great painters would go.
See if the inspiration.
In fact, I even painted in Monet's garden. I did a painting of Monet's garden. Of course, I'm no Monet, but I certainly.
You were there.
I was there. Liked to be Monet, but I wasn't Monet. Yeah. And also, I'm a collector of art. I have a wonderful collection of very, very good art that I've been collecting since the 1950s.
That you keep at your home?
Some of the works, like some of the pieces, like I have original Frederick Remington bronzes, and those things are in museums, you know, because of the value of a lot of these things. You know, Picasso, Chagall, that kind of thing. And, you know, it's, but they're like my little, when I get up in the morning and go downstairs, it's like, you know, this is my family of things, and I look at the work, and it makes me realize, especially some of the better work, it makes me realize how far I have to go to get to where they are, because these people were geniuses, really? You know. I have a letter at home that was done by John Sargent, and it's the letter that he wrote to Madame X about that very famous painting of Madame X. Mm. And when I read the letter, it's so interesting the way that he wrote the letter and showing his humility in the letter. And I thought, here was one of the greatest painters there ever was, especially an American painter. I mean, his ability in doing figurative work was over the top. And he could put so much in one paint stroke, it would take me 30 paint strokes to do one of his paint strokes, you know.
And he was still humble about it.
And he was still humble about it, yeah. Of course, I never met the man, but a person who I did meet, which is interesting, when I was in college, I won an award. It was a gold award. And I got the opportunity to meet Norman Rockwell. And I went to his home, and I had lunch with both he and his wife. And it was so interesting because he was showing me some of the things that he had and his work. And I had an opportunity to really kind of talk about it. And the thing that was interesting is I was an Eagle Scout and Boy Scouts, and he was fascinated by that part of it because he did the Boy Scout books. He used to do all the artwork for a lot of the Boy Scout books.
Yeah.
So he was more interested in that part of who I was than anything else.
Right.
And at that point, you know, I was just really starting off as an artist. But it was just fascinating to meet such a talent as Norman Rockwell.
Yeah.
And he was
yeah.
a sweet man. He was
yeah.
he was really a sweet
yeah,
man.
Yeah, you can tell from his paintings that
he was a real kind of American icon, one of the best that told stories about America.
Yeah.
He was a great painter.
So on that theme, what are some of the other artists throughout Vermont that you would consider today to be great artists?
Well, there's a number of really, really great artists. Gosh, I am almost afraid to use some of the names because there's what about me? You forgot me. I mean, good God, there's so many.
And isn't it interesting that Vermont seems to attract a disproportionate number of artists and more free thinkers?
It's the beauty of the area. When I came up here, you know, even years ago as a young fella, the way the light is here, and it reminds me of the south of France in many ways. You know, there's a thing about light and the way light works. Even the cloud formations and everything else. Like last night, I was looking up at the clouds.
I was too.
And it was unbelievable. And I have two of my artists right now that are out there painting. One of them you know. And the other you hadn't met yet. But in both cases, these people are out there every day painting. And it shows that, you know, that thing that they have.
Yeah. The light, speaking to that, yesterday afternoon we had this rain for the better part of the day, and then in the evening the sun broke out and everything was so rich.
Exactly right. The light, it would, where a cloud would break, you would have these patches of pure color. And then you'd have these other colors, and it was this play of color, you know, as you play with your fiddle, it's that kind of thing where you're going the highs, the lows, you're reaching all these various things. And that's
even this morning there, I don't know if you noticed, but early in the morning, the clouds were
hanging
tinged
over the mountains
with pink.
Yes.
And
because I was looking at probably the same clouds you were looking at. But that's the beauty, and I think that's what draws people to Vermont too. You know, I mean, it's more than it's more than just the sheer beauty of the area, but there is something about the light and the way the light plays on things, and the openness too. There's a lot of areas here that you see great distances, you know, and that's another thing.
Right.
I've always been a Western artist in the sense that I love the West because
the
openness
expanses.
And you get the dramatic everything. And I, even all the licensing pieces that I do now are all things from my imagination. It's all imagination. It's like close my eyes and, I see that scene.
I
paint it.
Yeah.
But there's so much beauty here, too.
Yeah.
It's a different kind of beauty. I love our
patchwork of, you know, like up around Taylor Farm, the fields.
And your farm is like every time I turn my head, there's a painting. There's paintings all over the place.
Right.
And some of the artists will be coming up to your farm and painting your farm because it's a beautiful spot.
I hope so.
It's wonderful.
That'd be great.
Oh, it's for sure. And some of the better ones the ones that are really, really good artists too. We have a lot of plein air artists in the area. And you know, these folks here really paint nature they really understand
nature. So describe that. What do you mean by plein air?
Plein air is a person who actually paints outdoors and does all
sets up the easel.
Sets up the easel. They find their composition, but they paint. They paint truly what's there. You know, it's unlike a photograph.
Right.
You'll never get a photograph that you can truly paint. Like even when I do portraiture work, I like to work from life, because and set the person up and create that image. It's you get the depth, you get the sense of color, you get the personality of the person. And so everything's in the eyes. And I always start with the eyes anyhow when I do a painting, because that's a soul to the person, mm-hmm. you know. And if you get the eyes right, you can almost get the rest of it right.
Right,
you
right.
know? It's so important. So those are the kinds of things that are, you know, really play a lot, you know, in understanding or plain air.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Is to understand light and how to use a palette. A palette, you know, it's like playing a piano.
Yeah.
It's, you know, there's a keyboard. And in the keyboard of color, for example, if you talk values means, you know, anything from black to white.
Shades.
Just in black to white. And then when you're talking color, that's a different thing. Mm. But on a keyboard, the middle C is exactly orange. Orange is your middle C, mm-hmm. because that's your middle gray. And then all your colors go like
diverge
this.
Diverge from that.
They diverge from that.
Yeah.
And then when you do your mixing and everything of colors, it all works the same way. There's harmonies that you create and how these colors are put together.
It's fascinating.
It is. It's a lifelong thing.
Yeah.
It never ends.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm 73 years old and I'm just beginning to understand what the heck I'm supposed to be doing. It's the craziest thing, you know. When you're a kid, you think you know everything,
right.
And then when you get older, you realize how little you know.
Yeah, exactly. You know? So true. Yeah. I like to think of myself as an artist with the farm.
Yes.
You know, and the working landscape that we have there, and
yes.
and constantly working with the seasons, and the it's very similar.
Yes.
In ways to what you do.
Yes, I find your farm fascinating. And since I've been coming up...
So do
up,
a lot of people.
Well, but I mean, fascinating in the sense that, you know, meeting you has changed a lot of things in my life. And some of the artists that I have also, being at the farm and just realizing there's another side to life
right.
than, you know, the way they've been living.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, it's like you're smelling the roses for the first time.
Right,
you know,
right.
And for me, it's been an eye-opener. And it's made me start thinking more in terms of, you know, how I want to paint paintings now. You know, I'm seeing a whole different side to just on Friday night meeting a lot of your folks and friends. And these are just a wonderful bunch of people, you know. And everybody that I bring along, you know, they're always like, wow, these are the coolest people, and it's the most fun I had in a long, long time.
Oh,
so,
that's nice to hear.
Yeah, it's a great place to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's a pleasure, of course, getting to know you too, John.
Tell me a little bit more about, you know, what brought you, we sort of left off with Jack Appleman.
Well, after Jack, then came time for opening up my own art gallery. And what I had in mind was, I had met artists in the area, and many of the artists in the area were struggling. I mean, some of them were struggling, and some, even the predominant people were struggling. And what I found was that it's better, how can I put it? I just felt that I want to do something that's, you know, good for the community, create more of the arts for the community, you know, bring in artists that haven't had an opportunity mm-hmm. in many cases, and also the artists that are you know, well known, you might say. I wanted them, and not only that, but to get to meet these people,
right.
get their ideas, get their thoughts. And what I've done with a lot of these people, especially from my business sense, is to take them and make them understand that I'm dealing basically with customers every day, and I'm always trying to create the needs of what the person's looking for in art. And so I try to convey that to the artist, because the artist's life is a very difficult life, because they're either cooped up in a studio someplace all by themselves.
Somewhat isolated.
Very isolated, or they're out in the field somewhere all by themselves, getting bit by mosquitoes and God knows what else, and they're out there painting away, and they're living in a different world. It's like you might as well be on Mars is to be, you know.
Again, it's not unlike farming, where
exactly
we tend to be quite isolated as well within our
that's right.
our world.
So I think what I've tried to do is to, you know, introduce them especially since I've learned a lot about art licensing, introduce them to closer to what folks are looking for. Because these folks certainly, the artists certainly have the ability to do that. Mm-hmm. But not to direct them to the point where I would change their style or what they're trying to do. Because
You're not compromising their style.
I would never do anything to disrupt what an artist is trying to create. Only just move them a little bit toward what the customer's looking for. Mm-hmm. For example, when we're doing commissions or whatever, you know, customers have certain needs or whatever it is, and some artists are willing to do that, and other artists, they don't like to compromise. So the ones who do, then we do the commissions. The ones that don't, that they do what they do best.
Right.
So it's one of those things. So we took the gallery, I took the gallery, and I started really, the first year was rather small, and I took whoever decided wanted to come in the gallery. But since then, I've been growing the gallery to the largest gallery in the state. And now I am bringing artists in that are, you know, prominent artists.
So you're more selective?
I'm being more selective, bringing in.
Are you yourself the review board? Or is there a, do you have
no,
a?
No, I do have other artists that I have high regard for that are in the gallery as well. I'm not one who thinks I know it all. And I don't, you know, I've been doing this for a long time, but there's other people out there that have ideas and thoughts. And I'm an open book when it comes to things, because again, my Uncle Ken always told me, don't think you know it all, pal, because there's a lot of stuff out there you don't know. So it's open, it's an open book, and I listen to everybody from my son to somebody that knows absolutely nothing about art, because everybody has an opinion about something. And everyone out there has a love. I mean, it's amazing how many people have a love of art. But many people aren't educated in the arts.
It's not very sophisticated.
It's not. So when customers come in, I love to talk to them about, you know, why certain things happen, you know, in art. And I think that's what makes it interesting.
Mm. You know? So you really engage with customers when they
walk in the door. I love people. I mean, I'm a people person. I mean, that's part of the whole business is people. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, when folks come in here, whether they buy a piece or they don't, The thing is that they're enjoying something, they're having a good day, and many of the folks when they leave say, this is the best time I've had all day, you know, that kind of a thing. Because I engage and I love to help people that way. Or even some folks, they want to take art lessons or whatever, that kind of a thing. And I love to do that. And we have fun doing it.
So you provide lessons as well.
Yeah, I do art lessons, and we have fun doing it. It's a fun thing. Sometimes we'll go out in plein air, sometimes we'll paint in a studio. But, you know, we do that as well. Now, also in the gallery, you know, I have a complete frame shop and everything like that. And sometimes folks come in and I train them on a little bit, you know, that way, you know, just for experience or whatever, that kind of a thing. And that's all very, very, very interesting. And the other thing I wanted to say that on the subject is that, you know, I'm engaged in other things as well, you know. I'm in the oil business in Texas, and I got like 28 oil wells out there, and then I got the.
How did that come about? How did you get into
a
oil?
A friend of mine in Houston. I went.
Can
up
I
to,
get in on this?
Yeah. Sometimes I don't know if you want to, John.
Yeah.
A friend of mine in Houston. Every summer I go up to Wyoming, and I spend some time with him in Wyoming. And while I'm in Wyoming, you know, we're always talking about things. Well, anyway, he built this incredible, like, $2 or $3 million house up there in Grand Lake. Gorgeous spot. So he was in the real estate business in South Florida. So I said, geez, I said, boy, you're doing great in the real estate business. He said, I didn't do the real estate. I said, what'd you do? He says, I'm in the oil business. I said, how do I get in the oil business? So it's a funny thing. So I got in the oil business. Of course, it's like throwing the dice as well, John.
Yeah.
Because when he threw the dice, it was like huge amounts of money. When I throw the dice, part of the dice is good and some part of the dice isn't so good. So I don't recommend, you know, on my recommendation to get in the oil business.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a tough business.
Yeah.
It's good and it's bad.
Sure.
So I got that. And then I have a company in India. I have five guys working over there, and we build websites. And we're going to start building websites. We build websites in the United States as well. And speaking of websites, art licensing is one of the websites that I built, including my own website for my own business and other websites as well. And it's very interesting because these folks from India, first of all, they're very grounded, very, very educated.
Mm-hmm.
And when I started meeting the man who runs the operation for me in Calcutta, when I started finding out about websites and everything, his name just kept popping up all the time, and I kept saying, who is this guy Sarab that I keep hearing about? So finally I get a hold of this guy on the phone, you know, and he speaks beautiful English. So we operate the whole business, which is kind of interesting, on I'm trying to think of the word. I can't think of the word now. Isn't it funny? I'm kind of stuck on the word. On Skype.
Oh, yeah, yeah, sure.
I couldn't think of it for a moment there. See, that's what happens when you get to 73. All of a sudden, you know, you're going along fine, then boom, it's gone, you know. But anyway, on Skype, we operate the business.
And I talk, have you been to Calcutta?
I've been to Calcutta, but not since I've met
not him. Business
but
related.
He's coming to the States, and we're going to be probably starting a corporation or business over here as well in that field. But it's wonderful because he's my friend like all my artists. Mm. And when he calls me, he says, "How's my dear friend John?" It's so important to have relationships with it. And I think one of the things, you know, owning an art gallery and being an artist is a wonderful mix. It's more, you know, sometimes business people, they think business, they have no concept about
personal
connection to artists.
Yeah.
And I think it's important, this mix between the people out there that are the artist and their way of thinking,
yeah,
and then the business side of it, and then somehow or another mixing these things together, and still they are my family and these are my friends.
Yeah. Again, very much like the farm. Our business is producing milk and producing cheese and selling cheese, and yet we create this relationship with our customers, and they come back, they love the farm, they come back time and time again because we create that bond.
And many of the artists that I have, I think the other artists have talked to them about, you know, about me, and they say, "Oh, that John Zacchio, he's a cool guy, you know, he understands us," kind of thing, you know. And like everybody has their problems, whether it's problems at home, financial or otherwise, you know, we all do.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, when things happen, you know, I understand their feelings, and I can relate to being exhausted from trying to create something, or, you know, drained, or
been there,
or sometimes being shy to meet people. Some really great artists are petrified.
Yeah.
I mean, they'll stand in a corner like this because they're so afraid of people. And yet, when it comes to their work, they blossom, you know.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
then they can't associate. They can't come together with other people.
Yeah. I don't want to skip over. You have a couple pieces here on the floor. The is it Neil Armstrong stepping onto the moon?
Yeah, this is a piece that this is the actual article here, and I don't know if that can be seen or not seen. But in any case, what I did was I did a painting of Neil Armstrong, and originally I did it for Grumman Corporation because they built the lunar module. And I presented it to the president of the company. And the interesting thing about it was that I painted it the very day they actually landed on the moon.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one of the first paintings, actually, of how it really was on the moon.
Mm-hmm.
And what I did is I painted the whole painting in black and white. And the only color in the whole painting is the shoulder patch, the American flag.
Yeah.
And then I put the Earth in the background, this beautiful jewel in the sky.
Yeah.
It's the only place that we know that's like it. And so in any case, Grumman came to me and said, "Wouldn't it be fun if Neil Armstrong was able to have the painting?" And I said, "Well, gosh, he was the man that landed on the moon." I said, "It would be my pleasure." So Neil Armstrong wound up getting the painting. And now that he's gone, it's in the Space Museum. So that's, you know, that's part of history. It's. You know, like it says here, captures the landing on canvas.
That must be one of your greatest honors.
It was a wonderful honor. Yeah, he was a wonderful, you know, I actually got to meet him one time. He's a man, he's unlike me, he's a man of very few words. You ask him a question, he'll say yes, and he says no. He wasn't like the other astronauts, I can tell you that, because I met a few of the others, and because I used to do a lot of animation for the space program, too. And it's interesting how brilliant he was. The fact that he even landed on the moon the way he did, because it was that last few seconds. I mean, it took terrific courage and everything else. But of course, these people are icons in their own right.
Yeah,
you know.
Sure.
And then there's another historical piece that I have here, which is kind of fun. It was the peace treaty between the peace treaty here, and this piece here. I have Begin, Carter, and Sadat, and I met all three people. And when I painted this was important because the very top here would have been Time magazine up here, and the idea was that it was the 31st anniversary of Israeli independence, and of course Sadat made it possible that there was a peace treaty that to this day still holds. Mm-hmm. So the idea behind the painting was that all these three men are dressed in the same suit, they all have the same tie on, and what I did is I have the red, white, and blue in there on the ties just to make it kind of interesting. Mm-hmm. And then I have a dove up in the corner, and the dove is flying with showing peace, and then the sky is clearing, and it's showing that all three men, you know, have the same belief system, mm-hmm. and that they're creating peace. So that became a very important piece. Now, the original painting was sold to Bank of America, I believe, and we sold the painting for $100,000, and we took the painting, and the money itself went to the Jewish Federation, and we took that money, and they used it, you know, to help folks in Israel that, you know, didn't have very much money, and they planted 1,000 trees, and they named the trees after, well, I got a plaque says I planted 1,000 trees in Israel, so. Anyway, so that was just a nice gesture. But so those are two kind of historical things. And then I had the opportunity to paint Gregory Peck, who was really, he was like my icon anyhow. When I met the man, I was so nervous. My hand was like, and he took his other hand and he says, you'll do a great job, don't worry about it, you know. And he was a wonderful man to, you know, he sat for me and you know, he was just a great guy. And I did Anthony Quinn and a very good friend of mine also is Tony Bennett. And Tony Bennett and I had art shows together too. In fact, he always painted Italy, and at that time I was going to Italy, and I was painting Positano and the Amalfi Coast and Portofino and all these places. And so Tony always wanted to know how to paint or to do serigraphy or silk screening. And so we talked about it, and we became good friends. And Tony introduced me to a lot of people too that were, you know, fascinating people, but he was a wonderful human being. And so it was, of course, without question, people like, you know, Anthony Quinn and Gregory Peck. I mean, these were great people.
You have such a rich history.
They were some. I had some wonderful opportunities, and you know, sometimes you look back and you go, "Gosh, how did this all happen?"
Right.
You know.
Well, I think one of the things that I keep coming back to is that you have never been afraid to embrace change, and that opens you up to opportunities.
Yeah. Well, I think that's what's important. I always think of myself, you know, sort of like a Renaissance kind of guy, because I love everything. I mean, my interest is like, you know, like I putz around on the piano, as you can see. and you know, I love art, I love music, I love, you know, like geology, chemistry, physics, mathematics. All these things fascinate me. You know, quantum physics, all this stuff, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think if more people were in tune to everything and be more open to everything rather than cultivate just one particular area of their life and spend their whole life in one area, because it's almost depleting.
It almost seems like our society channels us, you know, to be specific. And it's the rare individual like ourselves who have this, you know,
I think artists, to a great degree, truly see, you know, art, life, you know, in a different way than most folks. Most folks drive to work every day or whatever, you know, and they don't smell, when I say they don't smell the roses, they don't look at the trees and the colors and the sky and things the way artists do. And maybe because artists are always looking for a composition to paint too. But it's, there's something very special about all of that. And I think people are slowly coming around. I know my son is very much into that kind of thing, and I a lot of his friends are, and I hope that society opens up to more things and see more things and experience more things and don't be more diversity, and don't be afraid to, you know, to experiment. And you don't learn unless you make mistakes. The idea about mistakes is try not to do them again.
Right.
but of course we all do that too.
Yeah.
But that's part of life.
And we'll get to meet your son, John, in a little bit. And he's certainly in many ways followed in your footsteps. And
I would always take him on these trips. And as I was telling you earlier, it was so interesting because John, when he was a small boy, I'd bring him up to Yosemite National Park or Grand Canyon or all these places or the Tetons or whatever. And he would never stop talking. And I have videos, hours and hours of videos. And the other night I brought some friends over, and we were belly rolls. I mean, good God. It would be like that, and then it would just keep going and going and going for like 2.5 hours nonstop. And he was so cute. He was like 10 years old, but he's like, Dad, blah, 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 blah. Dad, look at, you know, that kind of thing, you know. That's great.
Well, I think we should take a little walk. I don't know how we're doing for time, but a little walk around the gallery.
Okay, that'd be fun.
All right, so John, I just want to do a little walk through the gallery. I see, you know, it's much more than just paintings here. You have a whole variety of beautiful sculpture. Tell me a little bit about this piece.
Well, this piece is kind of interesting because the artist is no longer alive, but the thing that's interesting about it is she took 3/4-inch plywood and she made a great big block, gluing all this plywood together and then carving it out into what you see. What's interesting is the texture that comes out of it because of the sides of the plywood, the way it was put together. And I find it fascinating, and not only that, but the amount of work that went into this particular piece.
Beautiful.
You know, that's what's interesting about wood. And then we have, you know, someone like this who does stainless steel, and it's very difficult to do stainless steel because you're dealing with different temperatures, heat temperatures and everything. So when you want to have two pieces come together like this exactly the same way, the difficulty is that they have to be heated precisely at the same temperature when they're being put together. Mm. And when they're being put together, there's actually like two pieces of metal that have to be joined, welded, and then polished later. So it's a lot of work to create that kind of a movement there.
Beautiful.
Then we get over to here. This is stone, like for example, in limestone. So you can see the artist in this particular case uses different textures, but you can see the work here. This is the earlier stage, how it would look before they get to this point here. So you can see there's so many different ways that they create these things. Here's an artist, for example, that uses a technique. It's called glazing. And the way it works is the paint's very, very thin when he is working. And so what happens is, think of the canvas being white. The light is passing through the color and then coming back out again. So it's like a stained glass window. Mm. That's what creates that illusion that light is coming out of it.
Right.
For example, this artist here paints, has a certain style and a certain look. And that's the way he sees things, and that he paints what he sees.
How would you describe that style?
Well, he's an impressionist, you know, I mean, to a degree, because he's not a super realist, he's an impressionist. He's creating an impression of what he sees, essentially.
Sure.
You know, the same as like this piece up here is the same thing, you know. Here's a painting where it's very simplistically made by Gary, and, you know, in this case here, he keeps it very simple. And his colors are very simple, but you get the patterns and everything, you know? And it's the way the light was that day.
Yeah.
Here's an artist who does watercolors. Mm-hmm. Now, his watercolors are almost realistic. And what he does is he goes out on site and he does drawings. And when he does the drawings are very, very tight. And when he finishes his drawings, he goes to his studio and then he begins his watercolor. But he doesn't use any pencil marks or anything on his watercolors. It's all paint right from the beginning. But when he does his drawings, the values and everything are so correct that when he does his paintings, they really look like the various mm-hmm. places. Mm-hmm. And these are all Vermont scenes here mm-hmm. that he does, you know, watercolor.
Beautiful.
And here is your young son,
this is my son Jonathan.
Yes.
Hard at work?
Yes, typing away.
John, what are your, how do you participate in the gallery? What are your roles here?
I take out the garbage and I just, yeah, I just help my dad with, you know, sometimes whatever he needs. I drive, he's given me his car, well he did, and so I've been getting plywood for him and getting glass.
You're the gopher.
Yeah, the gopher.
And are you an artist yourself?
I am a musician and I enjoy art and I draw and with pencil. I've tried painting with oil and acrylic, but it's a whole new world. It really is.
What is the word?
Well, the thing is, she's from Connecticut, but the interesting thing about her work is that she paints only outdoors and. She has a wonderful sense of design. She has a wonderful sense of color. She has a wonderful, in how she creates her compositions, everything is her sense of design and beauty. The way she, everything is, very, very thought out. Like her patterns, the way that she works her patterns, even her sky and everything. So she gets the essence of things. She doesn't actually paint the scene exactly the way it is. She paints it the way she feels it.
Right.
And she's a wonderful, wonderful colorist and a wonderful person. And John, you've had the opportunity to meet her. And she's a very spirited, delightful person.
Yeah, absolutely.
She's spirited, that's for sure.
This scene could well be looking up through the Meadowee Valley.
Oh, yes. This is a local scene, actually. This is one of the places that she's actually been here. And she's out today, as a matter of fact, right now, painting someplace in Vermont.
Wow, that's pretty cool. Hello.
All right, and let's take a look at the next room.
All right. So let's look at this painting right here. This is a beautiful painting.
Tell us about this, John.
All right, so this is Joanne Towers. She is from New York. She does lots of local scenes, right?
She does scenes that influence her. These are places that she actually knows and sees. And what she's essentially doing is she goes out to a place like this and she meditates on a place like this and she really kind of burns the spirit of the place into her mind. Then goes back to her studio and then she works on her paintings and she develops them. She starts very simplistic in design. She keeps patterns, she starts with her patterns, and then starts to develop. But each day, she keeps adding and adding and adding. And the more she sees, the more she tries to get. There's a lot of paint on the canvas when you get up close to it. But
yeah, you can literally see the texture of the
textures. But when you get back from it, the whole thing comes together. She's she's very interested in creating light in her paintings, feeling of light and motion. So you can feel the water moving. And I think some part of that is because every time you would look at a stream, it's not in the same spot it was the minute before, the second before. So rather than working from photos, she works from reality because leaves move,
yeah.
Trees move, everything's moving.
Everything does feel like it's moving, just like in nature. It really does. The light and everything. It's almost like when I look at it, the tree outside, I see the light and the leaves and the wind all flowing, and this is sort of like a still of that kind of feeling I get.
Amazing to capture that.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's very realistic yet, moving sort of
and
color.
Again, she's one of these people that she's very humble about who she is and about her work and how spirited she is in the sense that she works some days as much as 15 hours on a painting. A day, and she works every single day painting. She just her love of painting is beyond anything. She's bringing some new pieces in that she's working on waterfalls and some other things that are just Absolutely phenomenal, the way she's designing these pieces. And it takes her a long time to create a painting like this, but you know, when she's done it, she puts her name on it. She's put her heart and soul into it. And as you can see, you know, there's a lot of work in that piece.
And obviously you've put your heart and soul into this.
Well, it's true. These are all my children here. All, you know, that's the way I kind of look at it. All these people here, these are all wonderful, wonderful human beings. And what's so wonderful about it is that I have an opportunity to see what they're all about, because they are putting themselves in their work.
Yeah.
And that's
sure.
the beauty of all of that,
sure.
you know?
Yeah.
I just love how everyone, they put their emotions in the paintings, and that just makes other people feel, you know, everyone has their own sort of feeling they get from a piece, whether it's good or bad, it's still a feeling, and some people will look at it and be like, oh, you know, that's all right. And it moves them, no matter what they do. There's some sort of reaction to just looking at the piece, and that right there it means a lot to me. Especially, it's amazing.
Wonderful for you to be able to bring your son into this as well.
Yeah, totally.
And
I appreciate it.
Thank you both so much for sharing this with us.
Yeah,
it's
totally.
And, my pleasure.
Enjoyed.
Enjoyed
chatting. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do